Hello and welcome to the Oxford Society for International Development's panel discussion on combating sub-Saharan African extremism in collaboration with Rights Education. We really appreciate you all being here. My name is Charisse and I'm one of the two Africa events officers here at OxSID. And now Jono and Akshat will explain more about our discussion today.
Thanks, Charisse. Hi, everyone. I'm Aksha. I'm currently the president-elect of Right for Education Oxford. And yeah, just very much looking forward to speaking to you guys about such a topical issue. It's not really a part of the world that gets discussed too often, especially at Oxford. So it's really nice to have the opportunity to talk about something like this.
Hi. My name is Jonathan, and I'm the other events officer here at Oxford. Before we start, it would be lovely if you could all give a 30-second to 1-minute introduction of kind of your background and your area of specialty. I'll go kind of in the order of people I see on the screen. So Mr. Aliyu Gebi. Gebi, sorry.
Sorry, yeah, it's Gebi.
Gebi, my apologies.
Mr. Aliyu. That's all right. Okay, thank you. Thank you very much for inviting me to be on this important platform. I think I probably was introduced to you by my colleague, Ambassador Yusuf Tugga, who comes from Nigeria, obviously, and from the same state as me. I was a member of the Nigerian National Assembly, House of Representatives, from 2011 to 2015, where I was Chairman House Committee on Internal Security. I was also concurrently a member of the ECOWAS Parliament, where I was Deputy Chair, Trade, Customs, and Free Movement of Persons. And during the 4 years I was there, I was also the West African lead representative of the WTO. When I left the National Assembly in 2015, I became the National Coordinator for the Security Governance Initiative here in Nigeria, while at the same time advising the Minister of Interior on security matters. At the same time as a senior analyst at the DIA and the senior advisor at the State Security Service. I'm still an advisor at the Ministry of Interior on Security Matters and Strategic Partnerships, and I still maintain my linkages with the defense and security component. I have participated in the Northeast insurgency since 2009 to date. So if you've read the Bring Back Our Girls book, by my friend Joe Parkinson and one other. Some of us featured in the book, although some of the things there are not historically accurate, but yes. So I've been doing the same thing pretty much before then and up till now. So I'm from the Northeast, I'm from Bauchi. Yes, and I think that's about it. 30 seconds.
Thank you. Mr. Ben Nichols.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Ben Nichols, and I'm a professor at the George C. Marshall European Center for Security Studies, where I'm the course director for a program called the Europe Security Seminar South. So it's a program that looks at Europe's relations with its southern neighborhood, including Africa and also the Mediterranean and the Middle East. I came over here a couple of years ago after spending about 8 years at the Africa Center for Strategic Studies, where I was working on the transnational threats portfolio, heading up the programs focused on terrorism and on transnational organized crime. So I'm an academic, but I spend most of my time working with security and defense professionals from Africa and now also from their partner nations. I'm very happy to be here. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Mr. Max Abrahms.
Yeah, hi. Thanks for having me. I'm probably the least knowledgeable on this panel about this particular topic. I'm happy to be here. I'm sure to learn some important things. It's not crazy that I'd be on the panel. I mean, I study terrorism stuff. I'm not a regionalist, so I'm not particularly knowledgeable about Africa. Some of the most important terrorist dynamics, as you know, are increasingly rooted in Africa. I know more, or I'm not even a regionalist on the Middle East, but I do know more about that region than Africa. And a lot of, you know, the terrorism threat really took me there, especially ISIS during its heyday. I really focused heavily on, you know, its stronghold in Syria. And so now, as someone who's very interested in international terrorism, it makes perfect sense that my eyes would increasingly wander into Africa. And so I'm interested in many questions, really, but why is there so much terrorism throughout Africa? What are the various causes? Why are we seeing so much variation in it? I mean, why does it seem to be increasing? What are, maybe we could sort of discuss variation between African countries, because obviously there's tremendous variety there with different levels of threat. What are sort of the counterterrorism implications? To what extent does terrorism in Africa pose a threat to the United States, which I'm particularly interested in as an American? I do some consulting for government agencies. Is this the kind of thing that Americans could ignore? Obviously there would be bloodshed in Africa, but would it reach, you know, New York? Would it reach Washington? Given the zeitgeist in America away from military interventions, especially in countries that most Americans haven't heard of, what are sort of the realistic counterterrorism options available to us, given sort of domestic constraints and the tendency to ignore dynamics in Africa? So I have a lot of questions, and I don't really have the answers at this point.
Thank you very much. And last but not least, Mrs. Fatima Akilu.
Thank you so much for inviting me to talk on this panel. I really appreciate it. I will start with two apologies. I cannot put my camera on, I'm afraid, because my bandwidth is very low and I'm afraid of being cut off. So please bear with me. And secondly, as I explained to you, Jonathan, I'll have to leave at 5 for a prior engagement. But I'm very happy to be part of this panel. I worked founded the NEEM Foundation. We work in conflicts both in the northeast and the northwest of Nigeria, and more recently in the Lake Chad and Syria. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Akshat has a question.
Perfect, thank you very much. I'd just like to kick off with something sort of education-centered. So at Right for Education, something that we really try and do is we're trying to provide almost easy access information, easy access sort of non-biased information to sort of large parts of Sub-Saharan Africa. And I just wanted to ask, particularly Fatima, who's seen it, you know, firsthand as it were, how have you seen terrorist groups actively hinder education in certain areas of Sub-Saharan Africa in order to further their agendas? And then, I think Jonathan's just put the question in the chat as well, just in case it wasn't so clear. Thank you.
All right, so if I go first, thank you so much for your question, and thanks for your work on education. Absolutely, this is what we're dealing with every day. As you know, education has become a part of the theater of war as far as the terrorists and insurgents are concerned. It's by design that they attack schools and prevent people from going to school. We saw that for decades in the North East, where they kidnapped large numbers of students, most notably the Chibok girls. But in addition to the Chibok girls, they've kidnapped hundreds of others from other schools in the Northeast. Unfortunately, we're now witnessing it in the Northwest, where again, they're going into schools and kidnapping 300, 200, 100 pupils. And we're seen as a direct response to that, parents saying that they don't want their kids to go back to school. And in fact, a lot of girls are being married off because parents no longer trust that education is safe. So I think your question is pertinent, and the conflict landscape has changed access to education substantially across all of northern Nigeria, and perhaps also as we're seeing in some parts of the Lake Chad.
Can I ask a follow-up question to the group? Or what's the format here? Is that okay?
Like yeah, absolutely. I think we're trying to go for about sort of 9-10 minutes per question, but we're well beneath that at the moment. So yeah, that would be great.
Okay, great. So I think Ben will agree with me on this, but like there's a real opinion among political scientists, which is increasingly contested, which is that sort of like the more extreme a non-state actor is, sure, it might be more evil, but it's strategic behavior. And that's why non-state actors engage in terrorism, especially really gruesome acts, that there are all sorts of benefits to the organization. I think a lot of my research contests that empirically. And it shows that actually militant groups need to be more savvy than that, that sort of maxing out on atrocities, especially against civilians, and especially against like schools. This is what I'm the connection to the previous question. I would expect there to be, based on my studies, a real sort of reputational cost to the group. You know, that there would be so-called audience costs to taking schoolgirls, to blowing up schools, to coercing young girls into being suicide bombers. I mean, these are some of the most egregious possible offenses against the civilian population. And I'm wondering if there's a possibility that that militancy, at least in some places in Africa, could almost burn itself out by creating a organizational backlash, which would make it harder for groups to recruit. You know, if you were to ask me, why did ISIS decline so rapidly in its stronghold, I would say mainly because it imploded, essentially. It burned itself out. It acted too extreme. It scared off local support. It made regional actors less enthusiastic about supporting it and more supportive of organizational rivals. And of course, it elicited the largest counterterrorism coalition that we've ever seen, which just bombed the lights out of this group. So I'm wondering whether it's possible that one solution would be just sort of like a natural equilibrium where these organizations are essentially overshooting and locally and internationally increasingly communities and countries will turn against the group just by dint of its unrestrained extremeness.
Maybe I can jump in with a bit of a comment on that. So first thing I have to say is I'm happy to join you and share my thoughts. And these thoughts are my own. They don't reflect the position of the United States government or the Department of Defense. The place I work is the US government. So I need to say that at the beginning. I think what Dr. Abrahms Bax was saying is right in the sense that there's an essential tension in terrorism, which is that there's a requirement to use violence against civilians. That's one of the core definitions usually, or an element of the core definitions of terrorism. And of course, that's enormously unpopular among people. And if the goal is to win hearts and minds or to try to gain legitimacy or standing, there's kind of an essential tension there. I think one of the maybe particularities of some of the extremist or terrorist threats that have developed in Africa is that those actors are not necessarily fighting a battle for hearts and minds. They're in some ways simply establishing a monopoly on the legitimate or illegitimate use of force in a territory, because they are not rivaled or contested in some places by a really strong or present state. So I don't think that there are a lot of people who really like a lot of these organizations, but I don't know that these communities are really in a position to push them out. And sometimes one of the problems is that the state's not really necessarily able to do that either. So the idea that they might burn out because they're unpopular or something, I think is less likely in a place where they kind of have free rein. That's a comment on that first idea.
Yeah, that makes sense.
I think also to add, I think part of the reason that they engage in some of these extreme acts is that we're talking about them. They're in the media, so it does expand their own profile, if you like. So some of it is deliberate to get attention, especially the female suicide bombers.
Thank you. Mr. Gebi, do you have anything to add?
Yes, I do. But also, like the colleague from the George C. Marshall Center, the views expressed here are my views. I work for the government, so again, I need to make that clarity. I get a little bit uncomfortable when certain things are, for the sake of conformity, for contextual understanding, are tried to be literally shoved into a box so that it conforms and then the understanding is understood. Yes, kidnappings in schools as an agenda by insurgents or terrorists to ensure that people don't go to school, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, to a certain extent, but also how vulnerable are these schools? How easy is it for people to just walk into school A to take children rather than to go into school B? Laced also with the underlying fact that government is also willing to now pay for the students to come back for political exigencies rather than to secure the schools and make it more difficult for opportunistic terrorists or criminals to go in and take the children. So if we are saying from a perspective of ideological dogma, an insurgent group like Boko Haram is saying Boko is Haram and people should not go to school, juxtaposed with a government, with a policy that refuses to secure the schools, to make the schools that much more difficult for people to enter and take children from, are they also not saying Boko is Haram to the children of the poor? I'm only saying this because I think the previous speaker said they do work on education in some of these spaces, and the nexus, I think, if I heard correctly, between that and terrorism and how the one affects the other. Then secondly, again, I'm glad there's a colleague from the George C. Marshall Center, which I go to annually for the Silent Warrior military program. You need to understand what we're beginning to see in the African space, West African space particularly, is something that we have not seen anywhere else in the world. We're beginning to witness symbiotic insurgencies. And because of the symbiotic nature of these insurgencies driven by traditional grievances, then perhaps, again, the definitions here from an academic standpoint need to really look at the nuances of what is going on here. But largely, I agree. I'm sorry, you keep cutting in and out. I have terrible bandwidth, but I'm in the office now. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Does anyone else want to add to that? The end of that question. So this question is for Max Abrahms. I gather that when we hear the word extremism, there's a tendency to solely focus on religious extremism. However, other aggrieved extremist groups are also prevalent across sub-Saharan Africa. How does religious extremism interact with other forms of extremism?
I don't know, but I often think about extremism and how it's used. It's a very often, commonly said word, but it's very underspecified. It's important to really have clarity about what we mean when we talk about extremism. I tend to think of extremism on two different dimensions. I think of it in terms of political extremism, right? In terms of what are people's political preferences, and especially how much do they deviate from, the government. When we're talking about non-state actors, how hard would those political preferences be to accommodate, right? The harder that they are, the bigger the concession, probably the more extreme the political preference. And then we have tactical extremism, which is, what is the method that the challenger is using to try to achieve its political preferences. these different concepts are very often conflated, but they're really quite different. It's important to keep that in mind. For example, one could have what many would consider extreme political preferences, like Salafism, for example, and yet one could hold up a sign and say that they're in favor of this, in terms of their religious views or in terms of their political agenda. That might be seen as having extreme political preferences and yet moderate tactics, right? And one could also invert it and have the opposite, where you have moderate preferences, say, I want $5, but I go up to somebody with a gun and I point it to their head and I say, you better give me that cash. So that would be having extreme tactics, but having moderate preferences. It seems to me clearly that in Africa, we're seeing a rise in extreme tactics. We're seeing a rise just numerically in the amount of terrorism. It also seems to me, and I defer to the panel on this, but it seems to me that there's also a rise in political extremism, that there's more religiosity, that there have been Saudi-backed sort of investments, which have contributed to political extremism, and that this, really going back to the 1990s when people at RAND started talking about the new terrorism versus the old terrorism, where they started finding linkages between religious terrorism and a rise in mass casualty terrorist attacks. So that's pretty firmly established for decades, that certain kinds of ideologies tend to produce more terrorism, especially indiscriminate violence against civilians, often unclaimed, often with sort of nebulous political agenda. So it seems to me that we're seeing a rise in all kinds of extremism throughout Africa.
Thank you. Would anyone like to add to that?
I mean, even more specifically, like, what's the role of religion, do you think? Or at least, not at all to bash Islam, but in terms of how it's interpreted by its perpetrators, which we know is very often, which is just mediated through humans and subject to contestation by other people. But to what extent do you think these sort of terrorist actors believe that they're motivated by their interpretation of Islam? I'd be curious about that.
I think for me, having worked now with a lot of the senior commanders of Boko Haram, the decision makers and the people who really define the policy of the group, it's becoming to me less about religion and more about politics. And even when you look at ISIS, how they organize, I mean, they happen to be Muslims. And for me, they use Islam as an instrument, because they do have imams and stuff, but a lot of the commanders have a very poor knowledge of Islam. So it's more and more, especially with the younger commanders now that are running a lot of the different branches to the groups, it's really not about religion anymore. Maybe in the early days with the founder, Muhammad Yusuf, and to some extent, maybe his successors. But today, the young commanders that are coming out of, particularly Boko Haram, it's certainly not about religion. They use religion to control, and they use religion as an instrument for recruitment. But I think that's it, because a lot of the people who've come out on their own have said, well, we went there because we thought we'd have more knowledge of Islam. But when we got there, we just understood it's not really Islam that they're practicing. So I think the focus on religion maybe gives us a lesser understanding of the evolution of these groups and where they're heading to, is my take. Mm-hmm. But generally, worldwide, extremism is growing. So you're right. It's not just in Africa and northern Nigeria. We see it in the United States as well. And we see it in parts of Europe. So it seems to be a trend globally that generally extremism is on the rise.
I could maybe add a comment on this, but I'd also like to ask if, Honorable Aliyu Gebi has thoughts on this, and I'm happy to see you again. I think I've seen you at Silent Warrior and also at Flintlock in N'Djamena. But I know that you have a lot of thoughts on this, and maybe I can add a couple thoughts after you.
We lost him.
No, I don't hear. Maybe the connection's not working.
Oh. Okay, I can hear you now.
Please. Yeah, please.
Good to see you again. I thought I recognized you. Is religion a driver to these things? Yes, but I'm grateful for the scholar who was able to define another perspective of extremism. And here in Africa, in our spaces, we're dealing with, apart from religious extremism, political extremism, tribal extremism, ethnic extremism, et cetera, and et cetera, and et cetera, and et cetera. It seems as long as you are able to get a group of people together bound by a common traditional grievance, like we're seeing in other parts of of our country right now, then you can begin to develop your own trajectory in terms of whatever type of extremism you want to perpetrate. However, to dismiss the thought that perhaps religion, Islam, to a certain extent, is no longer playing a role, I think at this particular point, might not be entirely right. In the sense that religion is still what has a broader based appeal to most of people. In my country, for example, since we have a very loose national identity, your identity becomes either ethnic, tribal, or religious. And because we have greater groupings of religious identity, either Christianity or Islam, it is easier to contextually belong to one of the two, much more less than it would have been for you to be either a Fulani man, a Kanuri person, an Efik, or an Ibiobio. So religion does still play a role, and I think, in my opinion, will still play a role for the foreseeable future. However, the symbiosis between different groups and types of extremism and organized criminal franchise is something that academics should explore. If we look at what is happening in the northwestern part of Nigeria, for example, it is purely a criminal enterprise trying to give a false impression of some ideological inclination, which we know does not exist. I mean, the Fulanis that we call Fulani Ndaji, the Boros, are almost irreligious. But still, it is easier to now say when you're invading a village, Allahu Akbar, to gain some semblance of legitimacy than otherwise. But that nexus, that symbiotic relationship exists, and it exists more and more across the Saharan Sahelian space. Now, back to the first question I think the scholar asked about, as an American, should he be worried about this? And what is homegrown, what is organic? I think, in my opinion, and I stand to be corrected, not at all. For the foreseeable future, this is a local issue. In fact, within the contextual meaning of local, it is a local issue. In West Africa, it is a local issue that has a unique identity that still follows that same trajectory in terms of identity. If we were to take the stories of recent events where 300 Lansar people came from wherever they came into the Nigerian space to sit with the people of Alagrano in Iswa, to later decide that Habib bin Yusuf al-Barnawi and Ibrahim Gorgore, now late, to take the leadership. The consensus is they believed that this has such a unique local identity that a foreigner cannot come and stamp their authority on it. So it should continue to be homegrown, though with some franchise fees paid to IS Central or ISGS or whoever. But more than anything else, I think what we need to worry about is the symbiotic nature between different types of extremisms and organized criminal franchise, which is on the rise, especially here in Nigeria. Yeah, that's my take. Thank you.
So if I can maybe just add one more word, I think I agree with a lot of the thoughts that are expressed here. I think that religion is part of the problem and not the only, and maybe not even the main driver, depending on this context. But I think that part of the responses often involve religious actors and often need to. As just an example, I was in Senegal a few years ago and went to Tivouane for the Gamu celebration, a religious celebration, where the Tijaniya Sufi Brotherhood was coming together to for a celebration, but also asked the leaders of other Sufi brotherhoods in that country to come and talk about domestic religious discourse and what they could be doing to reinforce what is a long tradition in their country of religious practice, in contradistinction to some of the other religious narratives that are developing in the country, some of them from recent teaching from outside actors, but there's also a long history of reformism, Salafism in Africa as well, since at least independence. So in that sense, that was part of the response. It is true, like the ISS in the Dakar office has done recent research about radicalization in West Africa, and has found that some of the people that have been detained or come out of these movements talk about, you know, they wanted a job or they wanted to protect their family. And some of them say they were inspired because they hope to find religious truth or something. So it's one of the factors that inspires some people. And then I really agree with the idea that one of the real dangers is the mix of religious extremism with other types of divides and conflicts that often have been extreme in nature, particularly this tactical extremism that Max was talking about. So there are unfortunately some longstanding challenges between pastoralists and farmers in some places, and also ethnic conflicts. We see that in Nigeria and elsewhere. But also if you think about some of the ethnic conflicts that are taking place now in the Middle Belt in Mali, for example, this, you know, unfortunately we've seen that the terrorist actors have been relatively savvy in trying to mobilize and instrumentalize those other forms of grievance and conflict and violence, and try to kind of connect their agenda to those forms of conflict. And that's, I think, a really dangerous mix, this kind of mix that I don't know what Gebi was talking about.
Thank you very much. That was incredibly insightful. The next question on kind of similar topic is, what role can local government and infrastructure play in the prevention of extremism? This question is directed at the Honourable Gebi, if you wouldn't mind starting.
Yeah, thank you very much. Very good question. Our first line of defence is the local government. Our strongest line of defence, again, is the local government. And as long as the local government is not strengthened, and by strengthening, I mean for the local government to have full financial autonomy, that's fiscal autonomy as well as administrative autonomy. Two, as long as the local government will not be allowed to determine its own trajectory in terms of development and inclusivity, politically, vertically, and horizontally, then we will continue to have these problems. Coincidentally, there's a national security summit going on here in Nigeria now by the House of Representatives, and they are beginning to look at some of these problems. When I was in the 7th legislature, when we were doing the constitution amendment, again, we all agreed, all 360 of us agreed, we had to devolve power, we had to strengthen local government, we have to make the local government component of governance to be as strong and as resilient as possible. At the center, we passed it. But as with everything constitutional in terms of amendments, you would have to go and get 25% concurrence from the rest of the states. And we found, after we did all the good work in the center, we passed the buck, technically speaking, back to the state legislatures. Governors came together and killed it. And governors killed it only because governors like to control the purse. All the money that comes in, the money that should be for the state and the local governments, the governors hold the money, and they use that money as a weaponized tool for control in terms of political power. So I totally agree, in our space, at the very least in Northern Nigeria, if we want to fight any of these types of evils, first layer would be to strengthen the local government authority. Then perhaps as a byproduct of that, infrastructure. Again, I give a live example. a member of the National Assembly has no business developing infrastructure at the local government level down to, at his own constituency, ward, and so on and so forth. I totally agree with that. However, the flip side to that is because federal might would otherwise never go down that low, chances are the constituents will never benefit from any infrastructural project as developed by the federal government. So what is the solution? The solution, again, is to give that power back to the local government authority so that local infrastructure can be developed by the local government authority. Thank you.
Thank you very much. If anyone else has nothing to say on this.
I'll say one thing. The there's a huge literature on basically like the determinants of civil war, or sometimes it's called insurgency, whatever you want to call it. It's certainly inclusive of terrorism. And when you look at Africa, it has many of the determinants of these problems, right? Where sort of, just to be clear, like the dependent variable would be insurgency or civil war or terrorism. And then the question is like, what's sort of like the independent variable that can predict the onset of violence or the intensity of the violence? And in the case of Africa, it's just like it's all super correlated. Like it suffers from like almost all of the maladies which would predict violence. So it's very hard to isolate sort of the independent factors which contribute to the violence. I mean, you're all familiar with many of them, you know. Religiosity would be one. Weak local governance would be one, another. You know, porous borders, poverty, discrepancies in wealth among the population, ethnic differences, religious differences, unemployment, pre-existing conflict, weapons that are sort of floating around in large numbers, external intervention, regime change, economic degradation. Like, you could just go on and on. So I think, you know, a couple of these questions now are asking, you know, about these determinants sort of individually, religion, local government. The problem is, for analytically, is that you have so many of these problems all at once, it's hard to discern which is really the problem. And furthermore, probably more importantly, but prescriptively, even if we were to resolve one of them, you would still have, you know, dozens of other factors which promote violence. So it's frustrating, both probably from an academic and a policy perspective.
Does anyone else have anything to add to that? So my next question is directed to Ben Nichols. Have we seen any effective combative strategies against extremism in sub-Saharan Africa? And if so, could these be replicated through affected countries in the region?
Yeah, thanks very much. It was an interesting question. I've been thinking about it since we talked earlier in planning. And I think in part it depends on what we mean by combative strategies. I know that some of the work that, for example, Dr. Akilu is doing has a contributive factor to or a role in trying to prevent extremism. A lot of the, you know, local government work that Honorable Gebi was just talking about also can play a role in helping to stabilize regions, for example, and to help prevent extremism. If we were talking specifically in kind of using that word combative to talk about kind of the military element within this, or the harder security element of that. And I'll take it that way if that's okay, Sharice, if that's all right. So yeah, I mean, I think there are some positive examples on the continent, and you'd asked if they could be replicated. I think there are some lessons that we can replicate. I think the first point to my mind about this is to kind of frame it, is to think that in a lot of ways the balance, the counterweight to extremism from a policy or practitioner perspective is probably solidarity. The actions that really help to reduce extremism are things that demonstrate a certain unity or fellow feeling among communities and individuals that gives rise to things like, tolerance, respect, dignity, and reduces some of the frustrations and the factors that lead to violence. So development work and economic work, for example, can do that. Humanitarian interventions can do that. But so can military and security actions when they clearly play a role in protecting civilians. Protecting civilians on behalf of the security and the military is a act of solidarity, of social solidarity. And it's fundamental. There are a lot of the civilians and citizens in Africa who are suffering from terrorism really don't have that protection provided to them by the state. There are examples of places where countries and regional forces are trying to make advances and deal with some of the places where extremism has already become quite violent and quite developed in a conflict, right? I would mention the multinational joint task force, so the MNJTF, which has been set up with Nigeria and its neighbors, Cameroon, Niger, Chad, which has been an important effort to coordinate some of the military operations, allow for the movement of forces across borders, to coordinate actions. It's not a perfect setup. It's had some challenges as well, but it's been an important advance. Haven't always been able to sustain operations in the way that might be important, and so on. And we've seen some of those similar types of arrangements set up. There are countries that have set up specialized capabilities to be able to respond to a terrorist threat. I would argue that what happened in, I think it was 2015 or 2016 in Côte d'Ivoire, in Grand Bassin, the attack that took place there, the specialized counterterrorism force they had in Côte d'Ivoire was able to respond, mobilize within an hour and, take out three attackers who were at that hotel complex. So there are examples where we've seen this type of skill set, this type of tool in the toolkit be developed on the continent. And I would even argue, the African Union's mission in Somalia, AMISOM, for all of the problems that it's had and a number of the critiques that have been leveled, and often, rightly so, it's not been a perfect mission. The fact that a number of surrounding countries or neighboring countries have contributed thousands of troops to a mission that's gone on for 15 years now and have taken huge casualties, hundreds or even thousands of casualties, in order to try to keep at bay al-Shabaab, a major terrorist threat, and give a chance to a federal government to take on responsibility there, is, I think, it deserves attention and it deserves some recognition. It's not easy to do that. And I think the key about, in terms of what can be shared or the kind of lessons that can be replicated, I think it's really the principles of these things. The idea of joint responses is something that we've seen in the Lake Chad Basin, but now has been also developed in the Sahel with the G5 Sahel Force. It was even also used against the LRA with the African Union's special mission against the LRA. And I think a lot of the principles about really using defense and security forces as an act of solidarity means paying attention to the rule of law and making sure that there's consequences for abuses, because that we know can be a driver of extremism. And that's the kind of lesson that can be taken across regions. And I think it's something, we work on those kinds of issues here in security cooperation, defense cooperation programming, but it's something that I've seen that the African colleagues that I work with, the professionals I work with, take seriously and want to achieve and understand the importance of. So yeah, so it's a little bit long, but those are some of the thoughts I had, and that's kind of more specifically on the defense and security elements of that. But there are lots of other actors, Dr. Akilu, Honorable Gebi, for example, the work that they're doing also plays important roles.
That's great. Does anyone else have anything else to add to that?
I would just like to thank Ben for really highlighting the fact that we need a holistic, comprehensive approach that's both military and non-military. And as you know, the work of the multinational joint task force also has a civilian component where they're working hand in hand with the Lake Chad Basin Commission for and are very much part of the stabilization work that's going on there. And that includes building infrastructure, rehabilitation, reintegration. So I think very often we don't often really connect the dots and say that this is holistic and it has to be done with actors on both sides, on all sides. So thank you.
Yeah, thanks. And if I can just add a thing, I think that in Nigeria, you know, the de-radicalization or demobilization program that Nigeria has been trying to develop in recent years has both of that as well, along with the MNJTF, has this kind of military but also civilian component. I think, I'm not sure, maybe you have even been involved in that, Dr. Akilu, but, you know, that the Operation Safe Corridor has been kind of a military part trying to demobilize Boko Haram fighters, but there's also the Yellow Ribbon Initiative, which is trying to do work on the civilian side as well. So I think there's an effort to do some of that complementary work in Nigeria's case. And it's certainly, I think, recognized more and more by a lot of African colleagues that there's gotta be a kind of whole of government, whole of society set of responses. I actually mentioned I'm teaching in a course right now. We're just finishing 2 weeks of a virtual course. A lot of African participants. The beginning of the week was whole of society responses. The second session was whole of government and then whole of society. And it's, you know, it's items that really resonate with all the participants. The Africans and colleagues, and then also others from around the world for that course.
Thank you very much. Does anyone else have anything they'd like to add?
Yes, if I may.
Yes, absolutely.
There's a lot that is going on, even around a safe corridor. Just like the previous speaker said, and Dr. Fatima Akilu, who is a better authority on this than I could ever be. There's an unpacking and an acceptance of the need to deploy more components within the societal component of the non-kinetic efforts to ensure that something more stable, more robust, something that will have strong enough legs to stand on once the political agitation really, really kicks off and there's a change of government and it is sustained. And I'm sure Dr. Fatima is fully aware of the Sulhu process. Maybe Ben is also aware of it. That has been scaled up. I'm sure Dr. Fatima, again, knows better than I ever could. Safe Corridor in Gombe is just for male ex-combatants or low risk combatants, but we got permission just about 3-4 days ago to begin to work towards building the safe corridor for women and children, and then perhaps a family reintegration fusion center. Again, Dr. Fatima is the authority on this, where families will be moved in to receive some sort of therapy before finally being reinserted into society. But more than anything else, the shift is almost complete from a purely kinetic response to a almost fully non-kinetic, all of government, all of society approach. However, the one thing that we have not been able to get right is the reintegration part, because we believe that unless government incentivizes reintegration, there's always a tendency for the community to reject the people and so on and so forth. To that effect, I know there's a group that was in Kampala called the Kampala Group, went to understudy the LRA issues. There's another one heading out to the Philippines, to Indonesia, to Algeria, but more particularly to Rwanda, to understand how the nuances of how those things were deployed in those spaces. So again, yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Just the next question is from me. It's sort of directed at Dr. Fatima Akilu, but it's sort of quite a general question, so I'd love for everyone to sort of chip in. How much of a role can education play in combating the rise and influence of extremist groups? And if a good role, what potential strategies could we use in order to do it?
Thank you for the question on education. Let me start us off. I think for me, as education plays a really critical and vital role. But when we think about education, we think in more sometimes about technical education, about the process of going through school one grade after another and getting a certificate at the end of it, but education is so much more. I think Ben and all the speakers, I think, alluded to the role of values when we're talking about combating extremism. Tolerance, character is important. Education must be designed to be fit for purpose. What is the purpose of education? It's not just to get a certificate and get a job. It's about how you become a good citizen. How do you become part of a society? How do you build a society? How do you become a peacemaker? Those are all things that we must begin to think about when we talk about education. This is all both secular education, religious education, education you get within the family. We must begin to join up the dots and think of education as a wider tool for preventing extremism and for as an instrument for peace in our societies. So I think that's what I'll say to kick us off. Let's start to think about education in a much, much wider way than we have been doing. It's not just numbers in school. What is the content of what you're teaching them once you get them in school? And how does that then translate to making them a person that is equipped to think critically, to think logically? And when people come to them, they can actually, they have the tools to say, well, that doesn't sound quite right, to question things that don't seem right. So that to me is what education should be if it's used to combat violent extremism.
Okay, if I may jump in, if I can.
Yeah, please.
All right, I totally agree. And I'm pleased to hear Dr. Fatima talking about education, not only from the Western perspective, but from the entirety of the spectrum. I am an advocate of responsible parenting. My generation is probably the last generation that received responsible parenting within the spectrum of our own traditional value system. So if we want to fight extremism, we have to rebuild the family. For us to rebuild the family, our government has to play its legitimate responsibilities, meaning the father has to be given the tools to be the father so that the father can oversight the sons, and the mother same so that the mother can oversight the daughters. So responsible parenting is key, and this is something that must happen at the community level, at the home level. Secondly, the last time our curriculum, Islamic curriculum, was tinkered with was exactly 173 years ago. Usually our curriculum in West Africa is set in the Sudan. So 170 plus years, the curriculum has been static. So there is a need for a deliberate attempt to reform our curriculum. And if the curriculum is reformed, then perhaps books that we should be exposed to at a much, much earlier age to have some beginning of contextual understanding of, for example, Sharia. Sharia, you only hear Sharia mentioned when you have finished the ink and slate recitation of the Quran within the traditional context of the curriculum, and you've started the books, Iziya, Risala, Kawaidi, Hayatul Islam. Then you begin to hear of Sharia. But then, or even then, it is very, very superficial. So the only time you get to dive into Sharia is if you reach the secondary school level and you become so inclined to go to the Arabic Teachers College or you want to take Islamic theology and so on and so forth. So the curriculum, it is very, very, very important. I like to use this example. I went to a normal government-owned local education authority primary school. On top of every blackboard in the 80s in Nigeria was written, apartheid is a crime against humanity. Every single morning, we would recite that. I didn't know what apartheid was. I couldn't even spell apartheid. I couldn't even pronounce it. But I grew up knowing that apartheid is something that is evil, as it is in my DNA. So perhaps if we're able to devolve our curriculum, give a sense of ownership, a sense of uniqueness in our DNA, where, for example, Othman bin Fodio to me is a hero. But you cross the Niger to my colleague in Abakiliki, he's a villain, perhaps someone that started the Islamization agenda of Nigeria from those years. So our curriculum must be decentralized to the point where our uniqueness, our DNA is imprinted upon it. And then perhaps we would begin to build a more resilient a layer of society capable of the critical thinking that Dr. Fatima was talking about. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Can I add a?
Yes, yeah, absolutely.
So I agree. I think that there's a lot of importance about the critical thinking. I think it's true that a kind of formal education that puts people through the grades through a curriculum that's pretty outdated is not useful. It can actually be counterproductive. And it also has to be said that investments in teachers and professional development, regular salaries and solid salaries, those kinds of things are also investments that would really, I think, improve education. It's not always a position that's held held up and kind of remunerated and given the prestige that it needs because it plays such an important role. But if I can, I wanted to make one larger point about this. It's tied to this education challenge. And I think it's really in something when I think about the number of students who are probably watching our talk today, I was thinking, and it's about the fact of the of population growth in Sub-Saharan Africa and its importance. About 25 years ago in the mid 90s, the population of Europe and Africa were about the same. Since that time, Europe's population has grown about 3%, but in the lifetime of some of you listening to this program, about the last 25 years, Africa's population has almost doubled. So, and I think of the maybe, what is it, 25 countries with the youngest populations in the world, a couple of them are not in Africa, but 23 of them are. Something like 50% of the population in Niger is under the age of 15. We have declining birth rates and in some ways declining growth rates. But given the way that the population structure looks, we know there are a large number of young African children who are coming. And the real question is, what are the investments? What's the infrastructure? What has been put in place that we often say when a family expects a child, I remember talking about, it's Dr. Funmi Olanisakin. About a decade ago, I was with her on a program. We were looking at youth and radicalization in Senegal. I think she's now at King's. Great scholar, great practitioner. And in that conversations with her, she was saying, when a family prepares for a child, you set aside space, you ensure that you have care. You look for the food, the resources necessary. You get the education, the healthcare aligned when you can, right? Families try to do this. Have societies really started doing that? It may seem a bit off topic, but I really wanted to make sure we brought it up because I think this is a future challenge and one that I hope that those who are inspired to start working on some of these issues, who are coming into their life of their career, will be thinking about what we can be doing in order to make some headway and make sure that we can find a way to handle some of these realities and also find a way to handle them in a way that's just and that's equitable for everyone.
Perfect. Thank you so much. Those were really lovely, insightful responses. Does anyone else have anything they'd like to add?
I think that on this topic of the relationship between education and political violence in Africa, I would like to, we've been talking, I understand why, about, education sort of locally in Africa and how that could help limit political violence. But also I think the international community needs to think hard about, the historical record and its role in promoting chaos and violence and oppression in Africa. And that there needs to be learning broadly, not just in Africa, but outside of Africa, including Europe's role and the United States' role. And I'm thinking specifically about the intervention against Gaddafi in Libya and the effect that that had in terms of violence there and in terms of violence throughout the Sahel. I think that one of the main things that I sort of tweet about, if you have the misfortune of following me, is just how little accountability there is, especially among sort of policy elites, particularly when it comes to policies that they've supported and the very often negative effects when it comes to political violence. And so I would like to see greater sort of education or at least self-reflection from Washington and other capitals, especially in Europe, about the kind of interventions in Africa which have been counterproductive and which we need to avoid if we're serious about reducing levels of violence there.
Thank you,
you know, Libya, you know, Yemen, there are all sorts of conflicts where I think the international community has had a negative role, and they haven't induced the kind of self-reflection which would be required to avert another similarly botched intervention.
Yeah. Thank you very much. They were really, really lovely responses, really interesting. So thank you.
Thanks. So one extra question on my part is how, and this directs to everyone, how do these kind of groups sustain themselves and how are they able to continuously fight on in kind of the most arid and difficult environments? Perhaps Mr. Ben Nichols could take this one.
Sure. I mean, I think there are a variety of reasons why it's possible for terrorist organizations to survive. I mean, first is that, you know, if there's a serious terrorist challenge that starts to emerge, unless you really get out in front of it in a kinetic way, once it's established, it's very difficult to put an end to it, even with military or security forces. There's a more complex problem then that needs to be addressed. And most of the challenges that we're talking about, which are really well developed in the Sahel or in the Lake Chad Basin or in the Horn in Somalia, but also unfortunately now even the ones that are that were just developing a few years ago, like in northern Mozambique, are already relatively well anchored. Among the challenges are that some of the initial responses can overemphasize the military and security tools in ways that are counterproductive. And also, terrorist actors often benefit from going across borders for safe haven. So it's difficult to kind of capture. And they often are mobilizing populations that have legitimate grievances, a number of grievances, and you know that maybe a mix of legitimate and illegitimate, but that have a lot of grievances, and I would say many of them often quite legitimate. And so they're also trying to pull support and from communities that are aggrieved, and they also are able to just kind of coerce populations that are under their remit as well, and so. And then in some cases, when we're talking about those that eventually become affiliated with Al-Qaeda or the Islamic State, often from a moment of weakness or a position of weakness, when real advances are made against those organizations, they can reach out to a much wider community of somewhat kind of like-minded organizations and get support and maybe get a bigger brand or a bigger name at that moment. So I think there are a lot of reasons why they are able to persist. And a lot of it does have to do, I think, also with just state capacity and capability to project really kind of sovereignty over a lot of the territories where these terrorist actors are. If you take a look, most of them are operating along borders where the state is not so present. And the way that they can become present is often through a projection of kind of defense and security forces, which is a mixed bag and is not a full, As one colleague mentioned, those kind of forces are often necessary, but they're always insufficient, right, to fight terrorism. So those are some of the thoughts that come to my mind on that question.
Perhaps from Mr. Gebi, the Honorable Gebi, on how they're able to see themselves. Thank you.
Yeah. I was thinking of how to answer the question until after the last speaker intervened, and it became clear. But also from an organic perspective, a non-academic perspective, I'd say they are always able to key into some traditional grievance. Oftentimes these spaces are defined as rather than misgoverned spaces, but I think we have more misgoverned spaces than ungoverned spaces. So there's always some claim to some level of legitimacy, and they're able to either sustain themselves or to reinvent themselves because the spaces are never short of grievances that they could feed off of. Secondly, the toxicity of the type of politics that we play, where politics is always either ethnicized or under some more nefarious classification. So again, you have a zero-sum game where winner takes all, so much so that the national identity is always dictated by the creed, the tribe of where the current leader is from. So if it's a northerner, everything tilts to the north. If it is a southerner, everything tilts to the south. So there is never a shortage of oxygen for them to sustain themselves. And if we're talking about sustaining themselves also, again, in terms of logistics and funding, it is the same way the Pentecostal churches in my country in Africa sustain themselves, crowdfunding. We carried out some interesting work where we found out in a particular space, we estimate there are about 1 million young men, boys, selling from recharge card to COVID mask to wiper blades and so on. And if each and every one of them were tasked every day to make a return of a minimum of $1 through some means where it goes all the way up to the top, that's roughly $1 million every single day. I mean, you couldn't rob enough banks to get that amount of money every single day. So in terms of funding, again, they have been using GoFundMe for not much longer than the people who created the app. Just like the way the money will now travel from one point to the other, you have the Hawala, there are other local means of money transfers and money exchanges that the Western world is yet to catch up on. But by and large, there are too many layers of a society that are weaponized and that are toxic to sustain whatever it is that you bring out. So perhaps a task for people like Ben and Dr. Fatima Akilu is how our horizon scanning capabilities can evolve to see things before they happen in 10 years, in 20 years, in 25 years, in 30 years, kind of like how we're able to say in 50 years, the population of Nigeria will be X, Y, and Z. So perhaps that's a challenge. Thank you.
Thank you. And Professor Abrahms.
Yeah, this will just be my last comment, really. I've got to get going after this. One sort of intellectual construct that I think is useful, unlike many within the study of political violence, sort of tackles this question what are the conditions that favor or what are the conditions which would make it more likely for militancy to happen? And that same literature, I think, is useful for answering Jonathan's question, which is how do these groups sustain themselves? And there's basically two schools of thought on this, and I don't think that they're mutually exclusive. I use both of them, and I think that they both have a lot of explanatory power generally, and also in Africa in particular. One is, you know, the so-called grievance model of terrorism, which would suggest, and some of the comments already touch on this, at least implicitly, that terrorism is a response to grievance. That grievances sustain these organizations. And unfortunately, it seems to me, and I honestly, I really do know the least about Africa on this panel, but it seems to me that, I mean, it's easy to list grievances in Africa, which would continue very unfortunately for terrorism in the future on that continent, and which would continue to sustain these groups. Grievances like poverty, government abuses, often in the name of counterterrorism in terms of its own indiscriminate and repressive measures, Probably climate challenges increasingly will contribute to grievances, massive discrepancies in wealth. I think that these grievances are here to stay, at least in the immediate term, in the medium term, and that will sustain these groups in terms of recruitment. The other school of thought, it's not the grievance model, but it's sometimes called the opportunity model. And whereas the grievance model would predict that we're more likely to see terrorism when a certain area has more grievances, the opportunity model, as the name suggests, would suggest that terrorism is likely to thrive in areas where the conditions are propitious for militant groups, for them to assemble, for them to recruit, for them to mount operations, right? Unfortunately, I also think that the opportunity model, if we want to believe in that more than the grievance model, would also predict more terrorism, or at least continued terrorism throughout Africa, and that groups would be able to sort of sustain themselves in that way due to the to the opportunity model. Certain aspects of Africa seem like it gives good opportunity to terrorists, insurgents, to people involved in civil wars. The flood of weapons throughout the continent, unemployment levels which are very high, which make it easier to recruit. Porous borders, increasing involvement from other terrorist groups, which might start off as stronger, more involvement from ISIS, for example, in intervention in, say, Mozambique. So regardless of whether we want to subscribe to the grievance model or the opportunity model, it seems like there are plenty of variables which are helping to sustain these groups. And it leaves me, honestly, very pessimistic about the future of Africa in terms of the levels of militancy. I would predict that we'll see continued levels or even more levels based on all of these contributing factors.
Thank you very much. That's very insightful. I think Charisse has a question.
This is my final question. We've already touched on this, but I'd just like to ask, is there a difference in the methods required to combat religiously motivated extremism and the methods required to combat other types of aggrieved groups within Africa?
Honorable Gebi, do you want to begin with this one?
Thank you very much. You're too kind. Yes, there are. And in my opinion, the easiest one to deal with is religious extremism. If you come from the perspective of ideological belief system, where, for example, there are absolutes, there are absolutes within the context of Islam that the craziest Muslim and the most moderate in Western terms of Muslim must agree. For example, the place of the mother. To Sheikh Kau and to me, and to someone even more moderate than me, the place of the mother is an absolute. We all know, without any shadow of a doubt, the paradise of the child is below the feet of the mother. So if perhaps we begin to distill some of this theological absolute, religious absolutes, from a perspective of building consensus on how similar we are than dissimilar, it makes the notion of countering religious Islamist extremism a lot easier than political extremism or ethnic extremism or criminal extremism or any other type of extremism. So I totally agree, there are different means. Political extremism, for example, within our own space here, when certain opportunities are seen to be dominated by only a particular tribe or a particular part of the country, as we are seeing here in Nigeria, northern Nigeria in relation to some southern parts of the country, where almost every single day, representatives of the federal government are killed and things are happening. So those types of extremist behaviors, in my opinion, maybe I'm being a bit biased here, are a little bit more different, more difficult, more complex to deal than something that I know the basis for de-weaponizing are absolute. There is only one God, Muhammad Rasulullah. It is the Quran, it is the Hadith, et cetera, et cetera. And it is for the same reason why there isn't very much ideological shift between any of the Islamist insurgency groups. Where they have differences is probably because of political power, religious power, and so on and so forth. So I think, yes, there are different means, and I think the easiest one to deal with, in my opinion, is religious extremism, in my opinion. Thank you.
Yeah, I'll just add a couple of thoughts. I think I agree with the idea that there are some specificities of different types of extremism, including religious. I'm not sure if I would also say that it's the easiest, but I think it has different elements. I think it depends also whether we're talking in part about the foot soldiers or the leaders, and whether we're talking about kind of meeting the strategic goals that some of these organizations have claimed or not. So a couple thoughts. I think that countering it involves a lot of the work that Dr. Akilu is doing, and this kind of work with young people, but also religious education. I mean, one of the biggest challenges is insufficient or really unuseful religious education, which leaves people vulnerable, attached to a religious identity or religious meaning, set of meanings, but without a lot of knowledge or kind of ability to use that or apply that in their everyday lives. And so really finding a way for religious education to be more useful and kind of helping people become deepened in their own faiths helps to protect them or immunize them from kind of simplistic and destructive versions of teachings that claim that type of authority. So I think that's one element to that. And then I think when it comes to which types of extremism are more difficult, I understand some of those challenges that are different. I do think that it has been suggested, at least by some of the research that looks at the quote-unquote new terrorism, that religious groups at a strategic level or at the political level that Max Abrahms is talking about will often have maximalist goals that really a state can't do much about. They can't really achieve the, or really even compromise or negotiate about this kind of apocalyptic vision or something that some of these organizations are claiming attachment to. Whereas if it's a single issue form of extremism, that there's a desire to have, more resources allocated at the local level, and that's a form of extremism is developed around that, or maybe more autonomy for a region, things like this. There may be extreme tactical levels of violence associated with that. In fact, often there's a lot of violence with nationalist movements, but it's also positions that the government might be more in a position to negotiate with, or at least talk about and find concessions around that would be able to kind of limit that and handle that form of extremism. So I think there are some differences. They're all difficult, but there are some differences and some different approaches that are required, and some different options really on the table for societies and for countries and for their governments.